Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We are taking a break from the corona story today. You know why? Because one other very important story has played out in our subcontinent, which is of great concern to India, but which has somehow got hidden under the corona tension and corona headlines. And that is the acquittal of terrorist Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh for the beheading of Daniel Pearl, the Wall Street Journal journalist. Now, I don't have to repeat that story. You remember that he was a journalist with the Wall Street Journal, a very good reporter. He was investigating al-Qaeda's links in Pakistan. Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh befriended him and promised him to take him to some sources, in the process delivered him to people who wanted to kill him, and between them he was beheaded. And then there were visuals, there were pictures that were shared widely of one man in a hood holding his severed head. It was quite a grisly thing. It was also one of those early televised or videographed beheadings, much before ISIS had come into being and ISIS had started doing it. And this happened in Karachi, and this happened 23rd January 2002 is when he kidnapped him. 4 weeks later, the videos and visuals of his beheading and somebody holding his head came out. So, Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh was arrested, charged with beheading him, along with three others. They were all convicted for kidnapping and murder by an anti-terrorism court. Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh was given the death sentence. What has happened now is that 18 years later now, he had appealed that sentence in Sindh High Court. So Sindh High Court today, the bench headed by Justice Muhammad Karim Khan Aga and Muhammad Salim Jaisar, have acquitted him of the charge of beheading Daniel Pearl, of murdering Daniel Pearl. They've only held him guilty of the charge of kidnapping him. For that, they have given him a 7-year jail sentence. He's already been in jail for 18 years. So effectively what this means is that technically he can walk out of jail. Pakistan government has said that they're going to appeal it. And US State Department, which immediately expressed concern at his release, has also noted Pakistan government's commitment that they are going to appeal it in their Supreme Court. So that is where the case stands. Now, there are several aspects to it. But first of all, I'm sure most of you know that name, but I will remind you that Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh was one of the three hardened killers, terrorists, who were released in exchange for the IC-814 hostages, passengers in the aircraft. That is the exchange that Vajpayee government had made in the winter of 1999. In fact, in December 1999. That is the famous or infamous story where Jaswant Singh had accompanied these terrorists to Kandahar, where they were released and Taliban took over their custody, and Indian passengers in the plane were, passengers, crew and the plane were released. One passenger was killed before that. Now, he was one of the three. At that point, he was just 24 or 25. In fact, when Daniel Pearl was killed, Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh was just 27 years old, 27 or 28. Today, he's just 47 years old. So if he walks out now, he will walk out in the prime of his life, having done so much bad stuff in his life. I don't think he will walk out. I think things will happen. And there are cases registered against him in America also. So even if he were to walk, Americans would demand his custody. And given who Daniel Pearl was, he was an American journalist. He was also Jewish. When he was killed, the videos and the pictures that came out celebrated, quote-unquote, the fact that they had killed an American Jew holding his head like this. So those are things that are not forgotten easily in the American system or forgiven. So unless this is some kind of a part of a deep, evil, vicious peace deal, some evil, vicious part of the peace deal on Afghanistan, I don't see him getting out. But he is the man. So three of these terrorists India had released, which is a shame for India. One, as we know, is Masood Azhar. He came back and revived his organization, Jaish-e-Mohammed, made it much bigger, became the favorite of ISI. Very soon tried to launch an attack on national parliament, Indian parliament, trying to trigger an India-Pakistan war. Before that, he, along with al-Qaeda, although at that point we had not linked it to al-Qaeda, but literature that came out later, especially the book by Adrian Levy and Cathy Scott Clark, The Exile on Osama bin Laden's life. That book and many other books now indicate to you that even the attack on J&K assembly before that, the first suicide attack by terrorists in India, except the Rajiv Gandhi assassination, but that was a different terrorism, was also carried out by this group. So Masood Azhar, even now a thorn in India's side, Pulwama happened under his watch, Balakot was one of his big centers that was bombed. So he stays there. Second is Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh. I always look at the notes because I just want to make sure that I get the order right, because he seems to have a four-barreled name. Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh. So Sheikh doesn't come in front, it comes in the back. The third one, Mushtaq Ahmed Zargar, who was also known with the nickname of Lutram, he has sort of disappeared. I believe he lives in Muzaffarabad and is of no great nuisance to anybody. In fact, nobody quite knows if he was not going to be of such value to the Pakistani intelligence and terrorist organizations. Why was his release demanded? But that's a mystery about which maybe we will get to know better later. Now, he has been acquitted by the judges. Now, in India, immediately our response is that judges have been bought, that the judges have done something that they were told to do. But if you read the judgment, I have just speed read the judgment, and for your benefit, I have a copy of the judgment, for your benefit, we will be giving you a link of the judgment in our uncut series. Also, the link will be there with the description of this Cut the Clutter. So you can read the judgment. If you read the judgment, and if you know anything about criminal law, you know that if this case was presented to any Indian judge, perhaps the same result would have come. Now, one, it is a very badly botched up case. The police has completely messed it up. This is exactly the kind of creative writing police should not be doing. There are big mismatches. For example, it is well known that at least a week before he was formally shown as arrested, he had gone into the custody or protection of his ISI handler because he was an ISI asset. And ISI did not want to lose him. Who was his ISI handler? Listen carefully. His ISI handler was Brigadier Ijaz Shah. Now, I will tell you who he is, Brigadier Ijaz Shah. So about a week or so after that, he was shown as formally arrested. If you read this judgment, it's evident that some foreign witnesses who've come, American witnesses, others, they have given evidence of his having been arrested earlier than that date. So an inconsistency in the charge sheet or the framing of charges comes in. So obviously, in the typical fashion of the Indian subcontinental police forces, you catch a man, you get everything you want out of him or her, and then formally show your arrest. In this case, because they were foreigners who won't lie on oath, they spoke the truth, so an inconsistency has come in. But on the other hand, there is also a great deal of vested interest on the part of the Pakistani establishment and the deep state in keeping this under the wraps. Because if this story had opened up in its full glory, and the fact that he was in the custody or protection of Brigadier Ijaz Shah, who was the intelligence officer handling him or controlling him, that would cause a big embarrassment, because that Brigadier Ijaz Shah is now the Home Minister of Pakistan. So this is their wheels within wheels within wheels within wheels. So that's where we are. So who is this young fellow, he's always been described as LSE educated. LSE educated. But remember, he was an asset of Jaish. Before that, Harkatul Ansar, which is a kind of precursor to Jaish. He had carried out a kidnapping of four foreign tourists in Delhi in 1994. This was again a famous or infamous kidnapping. Three Britons and one American were kidnapped and they were taken to Ghaziabad and they were kept in a safe house. And against them, as ransom, Sheikh and his accomplices wanted 10 Kashmiri terrorists released. Now that was busted by UP police. And if you want to read more details on that, read the article by Avinash Mohanani, who's a former IB officer who served in Pakistan, who's written about this in the Economic Times today. Now, when that place was busted, all tourists were freed, unharmed. Sheikh was caught along with a couple of others. They were sent to jail on charges of kidnapping and murder. You know why? Because in the encounter that took place between the police and Sheikh and his terrorists, not in Ghaziabad, but in a village near Saharanpur, two policemen were killed, one inspector and one constable. One terrorist was also killed, but this was a chance capture by UP police and a great capture. It's such a tragedy that 5 years later, they had to be freed. He had to be freed in exchange for the IC-814 passengers. So that was his track record. Now, how did ISI recruit him? Or how did he become a terrorist? He could just be anybody. Now you can see ISIS is full of these young Muslims who've come in from European campuses. They are educated people who become Islamists and terrorists of the worst kind. So obviously, his mindset was like that. But Musharraf, General Musharraf, in his autobiography wrote that he had initially been an asset of MI6, which is Britain's international secret agency. It's like it's to Britain what CIA is to America and what ROI is to India. ISI to Pakistan is sui generis because it's everything to everybody. They also run their government in the country. So let's not compare there. So he says that he was an asset of MI6 because he had a bent towards Islamism. I make a distinction between Islam and Islamism. So Islamist is different from Islamic. So he had a bent towards Islamism. He was deeply connected or he was growing connections with groups in Bosnia at that point in the Balkans. And he was going there. So MI6 recruited him and used him as a double agent in the Balkans. That's what Musharraf says. We have no other evidence for that. But Musharraf should have known because after all, he was the army chief and he was the president. So he knew what was going on. Then obviously his loyalties were on the other side, on the Islamist side. So he came back to Pakistan. He joined Harkatul Ansar. He came to India. Nobody comes to India. You have to be very motivated. And then he got caught and then he got freed and then he carried on. Now remember, 23rd of January, when does he kidnap Daniel Pearl? 23rd of January is when India and Pakistan are on the verge of going to war. Why? Because just 6 weeks earlier, in fact, less than 6 weeks earlier, on 13th of December 2001 was the date when the attack on Indian Parliament was carried out by Jaish terrorists. Remember, the head of Jaish was released along with Sheikh. So, birds of a feather hang together. Within that period, even while the two countries were about to go to war, Americans were so active, 9/11 had happened the previous year. In spite of that, he ran this operation to kidnap Daniel Pearl and have him killed. Now, he's been convicted for kidnapping, not for killing. I think when they go to Supreme Court or wherever or any other court, this is not a kidnap for the heck of it. This is not a kidnap for fun or ransom or kidnap for the kidnap sake. It's a kidnap for murder. So this is a part of the murder conspiracy. I do not see how he can be acquitted of the charge of murder if that case is made out well enough. Now, more about him. And all these, I told you, these are all birds of a feather. If you read some of these books, particularly again, Adrian Levy and Kathy Scott Clark, you can see that these people were all working together. That is, Masood Azhar, Sheikh, Dawood Ibrahim, and another evil character called Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, who is usually known as KSM. Now, KSM is one of the key figures charged in 9/11. In fact, he has made a confession also. He is in American custody. He is one of those few prisoners which are still being held in Guantanamo Bay. He was also seen as a likely successor to Osama bin Laden. He is a Pakistani. In fact, all these three people are Pakistani Punjabis. They are not from any other part of Pakistan. The only Kashmiri in the group, Mushtaq Ahmed Zargar or Latram, as we told you, is leading quite a peaceful life in Muzaffarabad right now. So Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was caught, was interrogated, was tortured. That became quite a controversy. He's not been given the death sentence yet. His trials are going on. But he's in Guantanamo Bay in that very small group of prisoners there. So there was a set of confessions that he made. He confessed to 9/11. He's confessed to enough to be given the death sentence in America. But he also said in that confession that, look, I am the one who killed, who beheaded Daniel Pearl. And that confession came out. And he said, how did he? In fact, the expression he's used is quite colorful. He said, I decapitated with my blessed right hand the head of the American Jew in Karachi, in the city of Karachi, in Pakistan. American Jew meaning Daniel Pearl. For those who would like to confirm, there are pictures of me on the internet holding the head. Now, when he made this concession, then immediately people said, oh, under duress he's making his concession. Or maybe he's making this concession so that, because he knows that he is sunk anyway, because there is evidence against him on every major act of terror in that period, including the US embassy in Mombasa, a newspaper office in Denmark, everything. He was the key to all of that. In fact, CNN had then called him the most dangerous man in the world. So one belief was that, all right, if he also mentions this, he knows that he's going to go down anyway, then he'll save Sheikh and others who were his comrades. But the fact is that when forensic examination was conducted on those videos of one arm holding the head, they found that just the study of the veins on the hand, on the right hand, because one vein was particularly pronounced, that indicated that this was his hand. So obviously he had lifted the head. He says he had cut it. There is no evidence yet that Sheikh had cut it. The two eyewitnesses who had earlier testified that they saw him cut Daniel Pearl's head, they later told the courts that they had made those confessions under duress. So that is where the story stands. Now look at this whole snake pit. And they are all snakes, poisonous snakes. Just that one is a crate, one is a cobra, one is a viper of one kind, one is something else, one is a rattlesnake. Because some of them are from different organizations. So there was another character here called Ilyas Kashmiri, who also was operating in India, again a Punjabi, called himself Kashmiri. He had fought with the Mujahideen earlier in Afghanistan, then he shifted to India. He was from an organization called Huji, Harkatul Ansar, Harkatul Jihad al-Islami. Now, he is somebody who was caught in India, escaped from the jail in India, then carried out more actions in India, infamously had himself photographed carrying the head of a soldier of the Indian Army. The first case of beheading on the LOC. He took that head back and was given a 1 lakh rupee award by Parvez Musharraf at that time. And that picture was widely shared. In fact, it's very sad that if you try hard enough, you can still find it in some darker side, on some darker sides of internet. He was also part of the same group and they were all working together. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was more internationally oriented. The rest were more India and Kashmir oriented. And this tamasha was going on. So this is the cast of characters. Dawood Ibrahim, on the other hand, was providing finances to them. So once again, Adrian Levy's description, Dawood Ibrahim was so efficient at providing finances, financial support to them, that he was called, he was described at that point as something like Goldman Sachs of Islamic mayhem, because he would get you financing everywhere. So all of them were together. What's happened now? Ilyas Kashmiri was killed in a drone strike in 2011. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed is Guantanamo Bay. Masood Azhar is quite sick. I think there's pretty good information that his kidneys are in the kind of state where he's unlikely to survive for long. So it's a matter of time. Ahmed Omar Saeed Sheikh, right now he's got acquitted on murder charge. Technically he can walk, but I don't think he'd be allowed to walk. There'll be an appeal, or using the usual subcontinental method, another case will be filed against him. And I'm sure there are other cases, so he will be arrested. So this story will still not come to an end, but ultimately all these people will find a similar kind of end. In fact, if this man, who's the youngest of all, if he has any other, any different end, it'll be a tragedy not just for India, but for the entire civilized world.